You know already that my name is Kasia, but let me say a few more words. I'm head of Computational Ethos Lab in the Center for Argument Technology, ArgDiaP, and I work half-time in the Polish Academy of Sciences here in Warsaw, and half-time in the University of Dundee. My background is in logic and rhetoric, but for now many years, I've been working with computer scientists and most recently with computers and computational ethos, so I work quite interdisciplinary across different disciplines. So you've seen yesterday this roadmap for argumentation theory, and you already know that argumentation theory is a very old area of study, basically from the very beginning of the science in ancient Greek. It started with philosophical rhetorical approaches, or also logical approaches, Marcin told you a little bit about it, and then Michał Paraszkiewicz showed you a specific application in the domain of legal argumentation, showed you how you can use this philosophical and logical approach to argumentation in the to study a specific type of reasoning in law. So what we are going to do today is to make the picture a little bit more complicated. So we'll take a box like you do in formal approaches the label P, Q, or A, B, C, right? And we will look into the content of these boxes, right? So we will look in the content of propositions. So we will move from formal model of argumentation to natural language approach. And of course, both of these approaches are eventually trying to capture things in natural language, natural argumentation, but the difference is that in formal approaches like abstract argumentation framework and logic or legal, AI and law, we try to abstract from this content and try to do operations on forms of propositions, while we will move right now to approaches which try to maintain this textual layer and do operations on this textual objects. Okay, so how linguistic or computational linguistic look at the argumentation? It basically focuses on linguistic surface, right? The machines, the algorithms can't see anything else than what is written. It will not capture intentions, what is in people's head, what people want to do with argumentation. We can only communicate with express in this approach anything that only this that we can see on as a span of text or text units. So of course we can identify obvious bits of argumentation like conclusion as a text span, and then premises as text unit. But also what is important from the linguistic perspective is the existence of so-called discourse indicators, which signals to the listener that I want to reason, that I want to support my claim, or I want to attack your opinion or belief. Unfortunately, discourse indicators are very rare in natural communication. So in the ideal model, in textbook, you will have this discourse indicator present, but people are not expressing them. So we have to in linguistic approaches, we have to do some tricks to be able to reconstruct this linguistic material in different ways to capture that someone is arguing. So we have these three different text files, and of course you might also know that each of these text files can be implicit in natural communication, right? So this is what we call antonyms, and this mentioned this phenomenon of fragmentation is typically expressed as short as possible as in an economic way. Each of them can be absent in the real life, but most typically we have this indicator absent, which is a huge challenge for linguistics, and specifically for computational linguistics. One more introductory comment is that you can either look on argumentation, which is a relation of support, that I like bananas because they are sweet, or you can look at counter arguments, which is the relation of path, which is typical for argument for abstract frameworks. So we can try to automatically recognize or process either arguments, pro arguments, con arguments, or both. So it depends on our research goal. So where are we in terms of disciplines? We move to computational linguistics. So this is the part of artificial intelligence or computer science, or sometimes it's also based in linguistic departments. So for example, it's quite common in Germany. Manfred, for example, is employed in linguistic department of computational linguistics. In Poland, it's typical that the MIG and the K, typically computational linguists are based in computer science departments. Interchangeably, we use natural language processing term to describe the discipline that tries to process text in natural language, right? Within NLP, we can identify very specific areas that are interested in argumentation is data mining, or more specifically text mining. Mining means automatically extracting arguments or bits of text or arguments in particular. Why it became as important and why people bother about argument mining? Because of big data. And this is a problem that emerges especially from industrial applications. Many companies that are based on the internet, like Amazon, Google, and so on, they have to deal with this problem. And what does it mean that data is big? What do you think? How do you define it? Million? Kilobytes, megabytes, trillion.
Sorry?
Well, I mean it depends on how fast our computers are, right? They're getting faster and faster. So we can try to process data very fast. But then, we can have very super fast computers. But the one consequence is that they produce more data, right? So it's kind of like a never-ending chase. That the faster computers we have, the more data we have, and then we have to produce more the faster computers, and so on and so on. So it's a kind of a problem that, in some sense, it's either impossible or difficult to solve. But at least one solution is to be as close as possible from this moving target, right? So that's the goal for text mining techniques. And this is give you the idea that big data is not only about the volume, the amount of data, but also, for example, the variety of data. So it's the more the differences between types of data, the more difficult it is to process them, because you have to have algorithms that are adapted to specific form of data. And as I mentioned, this is a problem. I mean, academia, interest in academia is triggered by the problem in the industry. And this is some a few numbers that shows how difficult what companies are facing. So you have Amazon handles millions of back-end operations and so on. If you imagine, even if you look yourself at Amazon and try to make sense out of the reviews that people are posting for the product. Sometimes it's difficult if you have so many reviews. You know, it's difficult to make sense of what really people are saying about the product if you have 150 reviews. After reading 20 of them, you kind of forget what the first one was saying, right? So it's. And then try to scale it up for companies that then try to improve, for example, the selling strategies and so on. This is also supported very quite heavily by governments government want academia to work on them because of the social impact, right? So the idea is we will give money to academics, they develop the great technologies, and it will be better life for all of us, right? So they can see that the social benefits, and therefore they invest quite a lot of money in these areas of NLP and computational linguistics, and also in industry itself also is very interested in employing people with these kind of skills nowadays. So this is an overview of the general idea how you approach natural language processing. So if you have a bunch of texts in natural language like reviews on Amazon web pages, you also need to know what exactly you want to extract. So for example, you can ask a question whether people like my product or not, or you can say whether people are satisfied with the delivery, to speak of delivery, but you have to very precisely form a question. And then you apply some NLP techniques. Typically, you use techniques that are taken out of the shell, and then maybe tweak them and adjust them to combine them in a specific way, and then you have some as an output structured data. That's how it's called. So you move from unstructured data to structured data in a way that your goal was. How you wanted it to be structured, right? So for example, you could have a list of positive reviews, list of negative reviews, and list of neutral reviews, and also we can then try to classify positive reviews, why people like my product. Because it's cheap, because it's, pretty, and so on. Okay, what can we mine? People started from the simplest way of structuring data, namely figuring out whether people have positive, negative, or neutral attitudes. Simple as that, but it turned out to be extremely successful commercially in stock market, because you can process huge amount of data very quickly as a broker, and see the tendencies in the market and then decide whether you should buy or sell stocks. So it had an amazing commercial success, sentiment analysis. It was a lot of research done in this area, and a lot of experts in sentiment analysis from academia moved to industry. Then people started to make this question a little bit more numerous, and they wanted more fine-grained information, and they wanted to see, okay, so on what grounds people like the product, on what grounds people had positive attitudes. So we were interested in opinions rather than general attitudes. So for example, we could try to mine that people are thinking that Mercedes is too expensive, not only that I have negative attitude towards Mercedes. And then finally, the most recent step is to mine arguments, which allows us to not only extract information about whether people have positive or negative attitudes, or people think Mercedes is expensive or pretty, but also why they hold these opinions or attitudes, so to extract the whole argument structures. This is the area that is very very young. As you can see, that before 2014 there was almost nothing there, because our mining arguments is extremely challenging. But around 2014, people decided that maybe NLP techniques are mature enough, and we started to try to address this challenge of mining argumentation structures. And here we have this is just from 2 years, and after 2016 there's even more of the events dedicated to more and more people around the world, many labs, NLP labs that are starting to look into it, also labs in industry like IBM, and invited talk by Nansson, going to tell you more about argument mining in their lab. And now I want to only, maybe he will show this as well, but for those of you who will not be...
Now I'd like to show you a third capability which we've never shown before outside of our research labs. And this will give you a hint and a sense for where Watson is going. The real question is, can a computer not just answer complex questions and simple answers, and not just take massive amounts of genomic data and come up with better treatments for cancer, but can a computer take raw information and digest and reason on that information and understand the context? So one of the prototype systems that we're building is something we call the debater. We give it freewheeling understanding of large bodies of information like Wikipedia, and we ask the computer, with no human intervention, construct arguments pro and con on any subject we throw at it. And the result of that is what I'd like to show in the demonstration now. If we could roll the video, please.
Hello, and welcome to the IBM Debating Technologies demonstration. Today we shall focus on detecting relevant claims. To proceed, please select a topic, and I will share with you my top predictions for pro claims and con claims.
So as I said, we could throw any subject at it. I've chosen some here. Let's just pick the first one. So it will now look for all the literature and try to understand, as a computer, what's a pro and what's a con for violent video games. Let's roll the first one.
Scanned approximately 4 million Wikipedia articles, returning 10 most relevant articles. Scanned all 3,000 sentences in top 10 articles. Detected sentences which contain candidate claims. Identified borders of candidate claims. Assessed pro and con polarity of candidate claims. Constructed demo speech with top claim predictions. Ready to deliver. You have selected the topic. The sale of violent video games to minors should be banned. I would like to raise the following points in support of the topic. Exposure to violent video games results results in increased physiological arousal, aggression-related thoughts and feelings, as well as decreased prosocial behavior. In addition, these violent games or lyrics actually cause adolescents to commit acts of real-life aggression. Finally, violent video games can increase children's aggression. On the other hand, I would like to note the following claims that oppose the topic. Violence in video games is not causally linked with aggressive tendencies. In addition, most children who play violent games do not have problems. Finally, video game play is part of an adolescent boy's normal social setting. Would you like to discuss another topic?
So, as you can see...
Okay, so that's the idea. Of course, you have the tutorials on specific techniques for argument mining that you've seen... you've seen yesterday the first half of the tutorial by Manfred, and he will continue this today until Sunday and Monday. Martin Ferreira Farina will also introduce you to some specific techniques in argument mining. But what I would like to do is to give you a bit of a context and kind of like an overview for this arena. And now I would like to go through typical argument mining pipeline, how this argument mining techniques are created. Okay, so we start with text, and you will need lots of them, and it seems to be quite a trivial step, but in fact, even at this stage, there are some challenges, like data are noisy or not properly formatted, or there are difficulties of obtaining data. So for example, if it's in the domain that deals with some confident information, like mediation, for example, or for the matter legal processes. So that can be difficult, but the bottom line is that you need lots of that for this type of techniques. You need to collect a big data set, and people were looking at different domains, law, online, of course, social media, philosophical texts, and so on. But what I want to hint here, also draw your attention to, is that typically those techniques are narrowing down to a specific type of discourse, which is called genre, because you can expect that people are arguing differently in different domains. So you argue differently in the court, and or in the at the conference, or in a bar, right? So you will express it differently on the linguistic surface. So that's why these techniques are typically tailored to genre on the domain. And this is the type of text that we were working with. That's a transcript from the BBC radio program or MACE. Okay, the next step is that you need to either create or select annotations. And this is a very challenging step, because in fact this goes down to selecting a model of argumentation, a theory of argumentation. So you dig into this philosophical or rhetorical or logical understanding of what argumentation is, that Max described to you yesterday. And why is it important to have a good model? Because if you, I guess it's obvious that you want to model something properly, but basically if you analyze your arguments in a bad way, then basically the algorithm, it will be useless for algorithms, because they will not learn anything on the linguistic surface. So that's tricky. And one of the pioneering work in argument mining by Palau and Mons in 2009 selected a very, very basic, very intuitive way of understanding arguments, which seems to be very, very we have premise and conclusion, and then whole bit, which is an argument, the whole structure. And it turns out that it's actually not very good model. Why? Because the text part is not a premise itself. The text part can be a premise as a, in relation to other text part, right? So it's not a property of one text unit. So in other words, if you have a chain of arguments, A because B because C, B is both premise and conclusion, right? And so this gives you the idea that you can't really annotate things as a premise. B is a premise for A, but it's a conclusion for C. So that's, it has to be relational annotation, not as a property. It's not the property of the text. Okay, so that's the, another another attempt to annotate arguments, and this is interesting because it's tailored very much to a specific domain of scientific text, and you can see that here that the parts of arguments that Teufel identified was the aim of the research, then this is quite interesting. Also, what I did previously, background, which means related work, what other people did, contrast is what my contribution, how I'm better than others in my research, and so on. So the advantage of such an annotation scheme is that because it's more fine-grained, the annotation conveys more information for algorithm, but the drawback is that it is you can't generalize it over this domain. So you can't move it to legal text because it will not make sense, this annotation. So this is the annotation scheme that we are using, and again, which is of the labels, which is the specific, elements of annotation scheme that you associate with text pump, are in this case quite generalizable, but because you have many of them, the annotation task is quite consuming. So, what I want to convey to you is that you have to make some kind of you have to balance what you want to achieve and how much work you want to put in, right? So if you want to extract something simple, it's better to go for a simple annotation scheme. If you want to extract something more complex, you need to work harder. So it's always balancing the goals, the aims of the annotation or argumentation mining and the important work. Once you have text, you apply this annotation scheme. So basically you split text, segment text into text units and apply these labels. Like for example, you say, okay, this part of the text is premise, this part of the text is conclusion, and so on. And once you annotate all of the text, what you obtain is so-called corpus. And here you see the example of such annotated natural language text. So this is the BBC Radio 4 transcript that I showed before. But right now what you can see is that we use XML in this case to annotate. And this means that that someone thinks that argumentation starts here, and in this fragment of natural language text, it's difficult for savers to take the high moral ground. And this bit is an assertion, but argumentation still continues. And then we have another assertion: there are lenders and arguments, and both second assertion and argument is finished, right? So in other words, this text span is labeled as argumentation, and within this text span, you have two text units that are labeled as assertion. Does that make sense? Yeah. So this will be the input for algorithm. We use more complex way of annotating text because in our annotation scheme we have relations between relations. So this linear way of annotating text in XML wouldn't work. So we create argument maps that looks like that. And then once you annotate your text, you can collect it in corpora, we collect it in ARGtech corpora as a list of argument maps, and you can access them and process them in different formats and also re-edit them later, change your annotation. So this is a couple of examples from literature that you could bump into. So this is per early corpus created with the tool ARGDiaP, developed in the Center for Technology. That was related with the work with Moens and Palau that I showed you before. And this is our more recent annotation. You can see that if you have a background in computational linguistics, they are relatively small databases because they require a lot of time to annotate. Okay, once you have the corpus, you need to evaluate it. So basically, I decided that this is a premise, this is conclusion, this is premise, but am I right? I mean, you need to be sure that this is a valuable annotation, otherwise if you put it in your algorithms, I mean, the algorithm will not be very efficient with that. So typically what you do in natural language processing is to measure inter-annotator agreement. So you have one annotator that annotates the whole corpus, and then you ask another person to annotate at least 10%, more or less like 10% of your corpus independently. And then you compare the annotations, right? You can see that annotator 1 and annotator 2, in this case, were disagreeing quite a lot, right? Reasonably good inter-annotation agreement is around 70%, but of course it depends on how difficult the annotation task is. Idea what you can expect to see in the literature. If your evaluation tells you the annotation is not reliable, it was bad, then you come back, move to annotation scheme, maybe tweak, change the annotation scheme. So typically it is done by using error analysis. So you look at errors mismatch between annotators and examples and try to identify maybe some annotation, some labels were not defined. There were some information missing in the definition, or the definition was too narrow, and so on. So try to tweak annotation scheme, and then you re-annotate the whole corpus, and you move in this loop until you are satisfied with the evaluation with inter-annotator. That's basically, you can't move from this cycle without being satisfied, right? Once you are satisfied, then you move from the linguistic part of this pipeline into the more computational part, this of software engineering part, and you work on the NLP, natural language processing techniques, which will allow you to process this corpus. And you can choose one of two general approaches to automatically extracting arguments, either structural approach, which means that the researcher is looking at part of the corpus and trying to capture himself the type of rules or patterns in the language. So for example, he can see that every time that someone said because, before it was a conclusion, and after that it was premise, right? So it's a very naive rule, but of course it would, it, it, choose a statistical approach which will replace scientist linguist with a machine, basically, and to learn these patterns in a statistical way. Disadvantage of this approach is obvious because you need much more data and very complex linguistic phenomena like argumentation. It means that you need it's very time consuming. On the other hand, structural approach is very more prone to some assumptions that linguists have about the language. So that comes from this knowledge. So of course, knowledge gives that advantage, but also can project some defaults or assumptions in the linguist's head into the grammar, into the rule. That doesn't really. So in other words, rules of grammar can come not from data, from empirical data, but from linguist's head. You can always, of course, mix and match them, right? So it's a kind of approach, and I think one of them is represent this approach. If you select statistical approach, which is more common nowadays, what you do is to use some classifiers that allows you to classify whether something is an argument or not, or is a premise or not, so whether something has should be attributed a given label. And the way you enforce an algorithm to learn whether something has a pushing the associated label or not is by using features in the algorithm, such as, for example, unigrams, bigrams, and so on, which means that you try to associate linguistic surface. What is a linguistic surface? Like, what are the typical words that happen to be accompany a given label? So you look in that premise, for example, and you see that typically people were saying bananas when formulate premise. So that would be your unigram, and then it will be used for recognizing premises. So in other words, you put training facts in NLP. You put training part of your corpus, which is called training corpus, into classifier. You tell classifier, okay, find some features that accompany the labels in the corpus, like what are the typical, so what are the words or pair of words that are in the premises and so on. The sentence or text part is for premise and conclusion and so on. And then when the algorithm learns these features in a testing phase stage, you put in the classifier unannotated text. You use these features to classify, to annotate automatically your text, and then you compare it with your manual annotation and check whether your algorithm, which learned these features, annotated the text in the same way that human did. Okay, so this is the example of the automatic annotation done by textbook developed by Patrick Saint-Dizier. On our data, you can see here that, I mean, you have more or less XML annotation that I showed you before, but this time it is done by the computer, by the machine rather than by human. And the final step is this evaluation whether your automated corpus is reliable and makes sense. How do you do it? Typically, you do it through precision and recall. So precision is telling us how many times the program found ghost, which means that decided that a text pump is, for example, argument or a premise, and no, sorry, I didn't decide. And then the machine thinks this is an argument, right? So it's not existing argument, a ghost argument. And recall is common tags program list. So I put a label on a text pump, and an algorithm missed this label. So in other words, you can see here that in the first column we have manual annotation, which means what I decided for. So for example, I decided the first text pump is an argument, the second is not, the third one is an argument, and so on. And this is the decision made by algorithm, and in this case the algorithm. This make the same decision as I did. In such cases, we talk about true positives. Then I said we agreed also on the no label. In these cases, we talk about true negatives. And then you have human decided that there's a label, but algorithm did it. We talk about false positive, and in the opposite situation, false negative, false positive. And this is how you calculate precision and recall, right? So you take for precision true positives divided by the sum true positives and false positive, and this is a formula for recall. Okay, so that's very detailed description. Doesn't matter. I mean, I'm sure that Manfred and Martin will tell you a little bit more on specific examples. Just the last slide. What we eventually want to achieve is that we develop this pipeline, and then we take, for example, Wikipedia, like it was in IBM video, right? We take Wikipedia with lots and lots of data, which is unstructured. We throw it into the pipeline in our into algorithm grammars and classifiers that we develop and evaluate it, and then the output is a structured, automatically structured data. Right? Again, this is what this video showed. Okay, so just to summarize, argument mining pipeline is divided into linguistic stage and computational stage, and they are to some extent, I mean, that they are mirror, they are mirroring each other. The only difference is that in the linguistic stage, a human is working, and then in the computational stage, this is the machine that is working, doing work. Linguistics, what we do in linguistic stage, we need to collect data. We need then to develop a reliable annotation scheme with a set of labels that capture the parts that compose argumentation. Then we create we have to create corpus, which means that we apply these labels to our natural language text. And then eventually we need to evaluate this corpus, whether it is reliable for passing it on to computational. In computational stage, we start with developing NLP techniques, either in the structural approach, we create grammars, or in the case of statistical approach, we create classifiers and so on, and other techniques. Then we do automatic mining, which means that we create automated corpus. And finally, we need to, again, evaluate whether our algorithms did a good job, right? So this is the pipeline, and this is only to draw your attention that the only difference here is that in the linguistic stage, we have manual annotation.